I think we are the only youth group in Troy, or the young adults ministry in Troy Cities, who has its own app. What is that? Come on. Yeah. So now you can watch our services instead of trying to go on the internet. You just have your own app, and all of the testimonies are there. And plus, it's beautifully designed. You can take notes on that app. You can have a Bible that actually reads to you. Those of you who don't know how to read, or your excuse is like, it takes me too long to get through. Perfect. You click play, it reads to you. It has its own sermons, our healing testimonies, deliverance testimonies, salvation testimonies, all on it. And so we're really, really excited. I think in the new generation, this is going to be a very awesome thing that God is going to use. Amen? And so with that said, I want us to, before we come to prayer today, to keep this thing in mind. When David came against Goliath, we know that David defeated him with a stone and a slingshot. And Goliath, the Bible says, was extremely armed. He had armor. Every part of his body was covered with armor. But there was one part that was not covered with armor. And in that part, David sent, and I believe through the power of the Holy Spirit, the stone, and he hit him in that part. So this big guy, Goliath, this big giant, has a vulnerable part, and it happened to be his head. You know, it's not only Goliath that has a vulnerable part. You also have a vulnerable part. You may not be a very strong person. You may not be the most successful person, but you all of us in here have the most vulnerable part. And that part is our mind. We can have degrees. We can have good physical appearance. We can have a very beautiful car. We can have a wonderful house. We can have even a ministry. But there's one thing that you must keep in mind, is that you and I have a very vulnerable part about you. Now, some of you think that your body is vulnerable. It's true. It's going to die one day and turn into ashes. But that is not the most vulnerable part. The most vulnerable part is your mind. And the way David hit a stone in Goliath's head, and the Bible says the moment the stone hit his head, in a matter of a few minutes, a big man crumbles on the floor. If your head is under attack, it's a matter of time and your whole life falls apart. If your mind becomes under attack, it takes just a small time and your life will line up to the level of your mind. The Bible says what man thinks, so is he. That means that when my mind comes under the assault of the devil, very soon my life becomes exposed to also his attacks. As a Christian, not just as a Christian, but as a person who was created by God, you must understand that your mind is the Satan's attack. It's interesting how our country has the highest percentage of mental disorders in the world. No other country in the world has most people suffering in their mind than our nation. But how many people don't even go to the doctor who suffer with depression, with fear, with anxiety, constantly thinking negative, constantly thinking defeat, constantly thinking I cannot do it, constantly thinking, well, that's the way we grew up in the family, constantly thinking, oh, well, nothing ever good happens to me, or something is about good to happen. They're no, well, this happened before and it always turned bad. We must understand that Satan will try always to attack your mind. He did it with Judas. The Bible says that Jesus told Judas, he said, Jesus didn't say that. It just says in the Bible that Satan put in the heart of Judas to betray Jesus. He threw a stone. You know what that stone is? A thought. A thought. And that stone hit Judas, a disciple of Jesus. It hit him so bad that his world crumbled. He did not know how to defend himself from that thought. And then we find Judas's life end, not because he was so faithful to Jesus, but because he committed suicide. We see the same thing with Ananias.
The Bible says that he came and he lied to Jesus. And Peter says, he said, Ananias, why did you allow Satan to put a thought into your heart to betray Holy Spirit? Meaning, the way David attacked Goliath is a lot of times the way Goliaths attack David's. The way the enemy will seek to attack you and I, this area. And we as Christians have to keep this in mind. And not only keep this in mind, but keep our helmets on. And put on a renewed mind. Have a new mind. God gives us a new heart when we become Christians. That is a gift. But it is your and my responsibility to have a new mind. When you become a Christian, God does not immediately give you a new mind. That new mind becomes a reality when we listen to the teachings, when we listen to the Bible, when we, you know, come to prayer, when we fill ourselves, and slowly our mind begins to change. And when our mind is changed, the devil throws something at it, it will bounce back. Our mind is not changed, a devil throws something, it will stick. Why? Because the devil's thoughts, they stick with our old thinkings. They're attracted by that. Amen. And I think it was Dr. Yanke Cho who said that a mind that is changed, a Christian's mind, is actually three things. He said, one, it's when you think positive. Two, it's when you think constantly about miracles. And three, when you constantly think and orient yourself towards success. Constantly positive. You must say positive because our God is light and there is no darkness in our God. It means God is positive. God is not negative. God is not pessimist. Means to have a new mind means your mind must be positive. Nothing about God is defeat. Everything about God is victory. The second thing is that our mind has to think about miracles. Or you may say, why miracles? Because we have problems. And two, because these problems, most of our problems require miracles, and our God, that's His specialty. That's what He specializes in miracles. He likes to make impossible possible, supernatural natural, things that are difficult to become easy. And to have a conscience that is full of victory. That means that every situation you're going in, your thinking is above that. If somebody gives you a new car, that is not the greatest gift. If somebody gives you a new house, that is not the greatest gift. If your mind does not change, it's a matter of time you'll break the car and be back in the same place. We've shared the study that they've done to people who were poor, and they gave them $1 million, and within a few years those people became poor again. And they put millionaires into the homeless position, and they found out in a very short time these millionaires became millionaires again. And they came to the conclusion that being a millionaire has very little to do with money. It has a lot to do with your mind. If you read, for example, even the book Rich Dad Poor Dad, you will find one thing about people who are very wealthy. Now, we all have our ideas, oh, they're greedy and all this. And by the way, anytime you criticize something, it's a sure way of never having it in your life. Churches who criticize miracles don't have them. People who criticize rich people never become rich. And so don't ever criticize something you don't want to be. Criticize the devil and you'll never have him in your life. Can somebody say amen? And so, but if you read people who are wealthy, you know, because people who are poor say this, I cannot afford it. How many times you've said this to your family? I can't afford it. Well, the rich person doesn't say that. This is what the rich person says. How can I afford it? See, most of us, the guy in the book said, he said, the poor people work for money. He said, the rich people make money work for them. Now, at first it sounds like a cool cliche, but if you study the way they think, they're completely on a different planet. You're like, are you guys from like some other planet? They are from another planet. Because they think different. And so, and for most of us as Christians, I'm not talking about right now being wealthy. I'm talking about right now being a victorious Christian. Because for some people here, wealth simply means tomorrow is to get a car. For some people, wealth means simply to get a job tomorrow. For some people, wealth means to be able to get up without any pain in their back, without getting any pain in their ankles or in their knees. That is for some people will be their wealth tomorrow. While for others, it could be something else. Amen? The way we get out of our situations, I remember I was talking to Ravim once and I mentioned to him about the fact that when babies are born, the way babies come out of the mother's womb, and I've not seen it, I just heard about it. The rumor has it, they come out head first. Amen? Not legs first, head first. And that's kind of how not only you come out of your mother's womb, that's how you come out of every problem, head first. And most of us, what we do usually is this, is we want our money to come out first. We want our family to come out first. We want the father to come out first, the girlfriend to come out first, the boss to come out first, everyone around you to change so you can remain unchanged. And that's not how usually happens. And most of us, we pray like that, say, God, change him, her, and them so that I don't have to change. And usually God does not respond to those prayers. They go back into a spam folder in heaven. Because the prayers God wants to change is, God, change my head. I want to come out of this situation head first. Change my mind, Lord. Change my heart, God. Change my perspective on this situation. And it's amazing, as you begin to change, it's amazing how people around you catch and get the memo as well and begin to change as well. And so our prayer has to be, Lord, change me. Lord, change my mind. Holy Spirit, put a guard over my mind and over my thinking. Let my thoughts be synced with you. Let my thoughts not be a reflection of my past. Let them be a reflection of the greatness of my God. Can somebody say amen? Amen. And we will defeat every negative thought. We will defeat every doubting thought. We will defeat every thought of anxiety, every thought of pride, every thought of lust, especially to the brothers who may be constantly struggling with these thoughts. We can defeat that with the power of the name of Jesus. Can somebody say amen? Let's take a look at the scripture in the Bible, Romans chapter 5 and verse 17. And it says the following. For if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance of grace. Somebody say abundance of grace. Now say like with abundance. Say abundance of grace. And of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. Now, I want you not to read this as some old writing right now. I want you to read this as God's word for you. If by one man's offense, means Adam, through his sin, death reigned through the one, through him, much more those who receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness will reign in life, not in heaven, not in the sweet by and by, not when they die, but in life through the one, Jesus Christ. So Apostle Paul is saying, because Adam committed sin, death started to rule the world. And let me tell you something about death. It did not slack. It ruled everyone, from Alexander the Great to Mother Teresa. From Hitler to very good people. Death ruled everyone because of one man. Death did not rule because of many, just one man. And death started to rule. And Apostle Paul is saying that because of Jesus and his grace and his righteousness, now you can rule also. You can rule. The problem with us is that we need to learn from death to take our place and not give it up. If death would rule like you, nobody would die. If death would rule like me, people will only get sick and recover. Because most of us, we reign over nothing. Paul's saying we can reign in life. Now death is doing a good job and it's gonna reign over you too, don't worry. Are you reigning? Once in a while, who are you reigning over? In life, not in heaven. Most of us are gonna reign. We're thinking we're gonna reign in heaven. Paul is saying in life, reign. to rule and reign, you have to have someone to rule and reign over. Death has someone that death rules over. Unfortunately, it's us. You have someone you are called by God to rule and reign over. Over sickness, over sin, over Satan, and over your circumstances. God never called us to rule over one another. God never called you to rule over your mother, your father, and over your sister or your brother. God calls us to rule over our circumstances, over our feelings, over our sins, and over our weaknesses. Can somebody say amen? In the beginning, when God made man, He made him in His image and in His likeness. This is amazing. That simply means you were made out of the same material God consists of. God is eternal, was never made by no one. He is. He never was. He just is, always been. He just consists of this inside that we don't have a human vocabulary to describe, because it's a completely different world He is in. And angels and demons, all of these had a beginning. God never had a beginning. And when He made you and I, He took a part of Himself and put in us. Now God was always in charge. Never been to prison. Never had nobody boss him around. Never had nobody tell him what to do. Always in charge, always on the throne, and always reigning. He takes a part of Himself and gives to you and gives to me. That part immediately makes us into just like Him. Always in charge. No wonder the first thing God told to Adam, have dominion. Why? You came, you're made out of a material that's inside of me. And that's inside of me, rules and reigns, and that's exactly what you have to do. God says, I rule over heaven, but the scripture says in Psalms, God gave earth to man. It's as though God said, I make you in my image. I'm making you kind of like me, in my likeness. I want you to rule the earth like I rule in heaven. And I want you to look up to me, to learn from me how to rule. Learn from me how to have dominion. And Adam, newsflash, I gave you someone to have dominion over. There's an enemy of mine. I sent him your way. He's gonna be in the garden. You'll find him. Rule over him. Rule over him. You know what Adam did? Adam did everything except dominion. He did not rule. Adam made a mistake. This mistake was not that he smoked or he committed some sin. This wasn't that. It was the fact that the snake he was supposed to rule over, he did not. And you think God said in heaven, oh my goodness, my enemy, Adam just fell. Let me just kick Adam out, come and take power and just take over. You know how sometimes when you entrust something for your kids to do and you see they're making a mess, you push them aside and you take over? You know, God did not do that. God did not take over. Satan did. Which simply means everything that is happening in the world is not a consequence of God's activity, is a consequence of man's lack of dominion and the presence of demonic dominion. It's funny how when something bad happens, the first question we ask, where is God? He's in heaven, governing heaven, and heaven is doing good. God placed man over the earth. Man made a mistake. Man passed the dominion to Satan. And today the earth is a result, not of God's dominion, but of dominion of Satan. Now God still is in control. God is still sovereign. But He delegated the authority to us. You were made to have dominion. It's natural for you. When I came to the United States 14 years ago, I didn't come as a citizen. I came as a refugee. It took me a few years. I had to pass a test. and pay money and then become a citizen. Now, some people in this room, you never had to do anything to be a citizen. The only thing you had to do is be born in the United States. How many of you, you were just born? Citizenship just came naturally. Yeah. Just came naturally for you. That's exactly how it is with dominion. When you were created, dominion came naturally. Well, because of sin, most of us in here today, we know one thing is everything comes natural to us except dominion. Everything comes very naturally. Lying comes naturally. Stealing comes naturally. Negative thinking comes very naturally. Being depressed, oh, it comes very naturally, especially on Mondays when the coffee shop is closed. Everything comes very naturally. Hurting people, not being able to make a good life, not being able to make it just make sense of my life, not being able to be in peace. All of that comes very naturally. Today, it is not natural for men to have dominion. It is natural for men to be under dominion. It's not natural. That's why when somebody says to have dominion, if you are really paying attention, in your heart, there is a sense of, yeah, good sermon, good preach, amen. But that's not true. And honestly, you're right. It doesn't come naturally. That's why Apostle Paul says, at first, you were able to have dominion naturally because you were created. Now, you're naturally dominated. But he says, right now, there's something else that is happening. He said, God, it came on earth. He gave his son, Jesus Christ, so that you can receive no longer his image. You already have that image. You need something else from him today. His righteousness. And his grace. Why? It's interesting how God did not say you need to have a remodeling over your character. You need to kind of improve on your life. And once you kind of get it up a little bit up, you'll be able to kind of feel that authority again and go whack the devil one more time. God knows the state we are in, it cannot be remodeled. The only thing that will lift us up from defeat is not just changing my life, which what the world is doing. I already have his image, but it's sort of down because of my sin nature. And God says, in order for you to feel strong again, conquer again, overcome again, come against the devil, come against sin, come against sickness, come against your circumstances. He says, you need one more thing in your life. You need a gift of righteousness. You need just abundance of grace. And he says, when you receive that, you can once again take your original position of reigning in life through Jesus Christ. You were created to reign. But because of sin, now it's natural for you to be ruled over. But Jesus said, because of my righteousness, you can rule once again. Let's just read one more scripture that most of us are very familiar with. In John chapter 3, verse 15, it says the following, that this is verse 16. Whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Jesus looks at Nicodemus and he tells him, he says, do you remember a story in the Old Testament where Moses lifted a serpent? And Israel was asked, anybody who got bitten by a serpent? See, Israel complained in the wilderness and they got bitten by snakes. And these snakes bit them and they were so poisonous that people were dying. And God had a cure for them, and the cure was this. God said, I want you, Moses, to not to take the snake that bites people, but make something that looks like the snake that bites people. Make it out of bronze, make it like looking red, and I want you to lift it up, and when people will look at the snake, all of the people who have a poison in their body, the poison will disappear and people will be healthy again. And that's exactly what Moses did. It's amazing that people were asked to look at something that looked like that which bit them. And when they will look at it, the Bible says that poison will disappear and they will be immediately healed. Imagine you have a poison in your body. Most likely it itches. Most likely it hurts. And the cure was not trying to band-aid the poison, pay attention to the poison, but to ignore the poison and look at something else completely that's hanging up. And Jesus is saying that this is an example of what's going to happen to me. How could Jesus compare himself to a serpent? He's always compared to a lion, a lamb. He's always compared to these beautiful animals. A serpent is symbolic of Satan. It's symbolic of sin. How could Jesus say he is a serpent hanging on the cross? Now this is a secret. It's a very simple secret. But it's a very revolutionary secret. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, it says this: "For he," God, "made him," Jesus, "who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become righteousness of God in him." I want you to listen very carefully. This is where the freedom exists for ruling in life. On the cross, Jesus was sin. Most of us just believe that Jesus just took my sin. The Bible says that on the cross, he who knew no sin became sin, that you who know no righteousness can become righteousness. Jesus on the cross was not just a lamb. He was also a serpent. He had to become bad. Don't never once doing something bad. So that people who've never done anything good in their life can become good. How did Jesus become bad? Did Jesus steal something from someone before he got on the cross? Did Jesus punch somebody in the face before he got on the cross? Did Jesus open his mouth and F-bombs came out of his mouth before he got on the cross? No. He did nothing. How did he got all of the sin? The Father just gave it to him. Why? So the same way he can give you righteousness without ever doing anything right. Just a gift. Imagine. Nothing. Jesus did nothing wrong. But dying as a wrong man. Why? So that people who've never done anything right can rule as though they lived their whole life being righteous. I want you to know today, as a Christian, you cannot reign in life because you're perfect. You'll never be perfect enough. You cannot reign in life because you are somehow achieved a level of spiritual depth with God. You can only rule in life when you open your mind to the reality that righteousness is a gift. Gift to be received. How? Ask Jesus, how did he receive sin? By opening his life to the Father's will. When you open your life to the Father's will and say, "Father, I'm a sinner. I'm tired of living under subjection of my circumstances. I'm tired of demons and devils walking over my life every single day. I'm tired of being addicted to this thing. And God, you created me for more than this. I feel it inside of me every day. That's why I'm not happy with it. A dog can be happy with being on a leash, but I'm not, because I'm not a dog. I'm made out of the same material you have inside of you, God. That's why something inside of me always rebels. Something inside of me always says, no, that's not how it's supposed to be. I know that I'm doing it day after day, and I'm probably doing it day after day after today, but something inside says, there has to be more. There has to be more. You have an image of God inside of you. And that image is the image that never goes under. It always rules over. but that image has been marred by sin. And God is saying the only way you can rise up again is not just by doing something more, it's that you have to receive righteousness the same way Jesus received sin. Opening yourself up and say, God, I can't do it, give me that gift. And when that righteousness is imparted, when that righteousness is received, something rises up inside of me. Something rises up inside of you. You know what that is? Boldness. There's one thing you know about righteous people. They're cocky. When you didn't steal something and they accuse you of stealing, you're not going to take it. When somebody accuses you of something that you didn't do, you have a backbone. You have fierceness in your face. You have a volume in your voice. Don't just simply say, oh, it's fine. It's okay. It's okay. Yeah, I can go to prison. No problem. Oh, no. Spit comes out of your mouth. You stand your ground because you know. They need to find it. They need to search it because something righteousness gives. The Bible says a righteous man is as bold as a lion. And that's what Satan wants to bring, guilt and condemnation and shame and anything he can to remind you, listen, you, this is not for you. You're a dog on a leash, and rejoice, I didn't kill you yet. He wants to remove that sense of righteousness, because if he removes that, with that also goes my faith and my boldness. And without my faith and without my boldness, guess what happens? I will settle for being ruled over instead of aiming for dominating in my life. I want to encourage you right now. You can come against the devil, not because you're perfect. The Bible says they overcome Satan by the power of the blood of Jesus. The Bible doesn't say they overcome Satan because they finished a seminary. The Bible doesn't say they overcome Satan because they memorized 25,000 verses in the Bible. The Bible says they overcome Satan because they have a sense of awareness inside of them. I am righteous, not because I'm a pastor. I'm righteous, not because I'm a home group leader. I'm righteous, not because this whole week I haven't done anything that I feel guilty about. I am righteous the same way Jesus was sinner. A gift. He got the bad gift. I got a really good one. Jesus suffered because of that gift. It would be foolish not to enjoy it. It would be foolish not to use it and say, Jesus died for it. I'm gonna stand on it to rule and reign. Every person in this room, you're God's candidate to rise up above your circumstances. Maybe in your family, everybody died out of a particular sickness. You are different because you can reign in life through Jesus Christ. Maybe in your family, everybody had broken relationships and children from different parents just because they could not put the family together. And maybe that is how your life has started. And I want to tell you something, that because of righteousness, you can have a new outlook. You may look at yourself today saying, me, Vlad? No. It's because Adam rules over you. Jesus says he wants you to rule because of his righteousness. It means you can have a healthy family. You can have love in a relationship. Not when a wife and a husband run at each other with knives, but they can run at each other with hugs. That is what God wants. Maybe everybody in your generation have always lived in lack and shortage. And you always had this word, we can't afford this. This is not going to be us. We can't afford this. Our lights get always turned off. We never have enough money for gas. And we don't have enough money to give to nobody else. And poverty always dominated. I have a word for you today. Through Jesus Christ, through the gift of righteousness, you can overcome your situation. Maybe you had demonic voices constantly attacking your life. Demonic things constantly, you just know it's demons. I mean, you could feel it all around you. And you're so weak to overcome against it. You are weak. But the Bible says because of his righteousness, you can overcome. You can overcome. You can overcome. Jesus was perfect. Became a sin. So that person like me, nasty, sinful, arrogant, hypocrite, not measuring up, my own worst critic, I can have a chance to have his gift imparted unto me the same way my nastiness was imparted unto him. If he took it willingly and died for it, I'm gonna learn from him. Take willingly and reign with it. Let's do it together. Let's beat that old devil out of our life. Let's stamp all those demons out from under our feet where they're supposed to belong. Let's rise above the situations that Satan put us under. And let's put that leash that Satan put on our necks and say, you know what, this doesn't belong on my neck. Last time I checked, Jesus gave authority and dominion over you for me, not the other way around. Can somebody say amen? And we will be a triumphant church. We will be triumphant Christians. We're going to be triumphant fathers and mothers. We're going to be triumphant young people. We're going to be triumphant bosses and employers. And we're going to be the people who will see the kingdom of God rule and reign in our generation for the glory of God. Can somebody say amen? Say, victory is mine. Say, victory is yours. Say, victory is mine. In Jesus' name.